So, let me get onto the window. All right. Hi, everybody. To begin with, thank you for joining everybody today, late afternoon, early evening. So, to begin with, I would request all of you to keep your video off and also mute yourselves throughout the entire session. Any questions that you want to pose, please type it on the chat option that is there on the right-hand side if you're on the computer screen, or you would see it at the bottom of your phone if you're using a phone or to log into the session. So we will try to accommodate as many questions as we can today. Please try to keep your questions brief. And as far as viewing is concerned, you should be able to see, if you keep it on the regular default mode, you should be able to see each panel, each speaker as they speak. But if you want to view everybody together, you can keep it in the panel view, so all the four speakers will be visible to you and their responses. So I welcome everybody and thank you for joining the session. This is essentially a March for Science group event, and it was inspired by multiple parallel movements. Our main persuasion is towards developing scientific temper, inculcating scientific temper in the larger populace, supporting evidence-based evaluation, both in policymaking and implementation, and an aim to equalize education in gender as well as economic equity, and essentially be inclusive to other movements like, you know, Me Too, Black Lives Matter, and so on. So this session is kind of influenced by all of these together, put together. To introduce myself, I am Subhajit Sen. I am a Ramalingaswamy Fellow at the UMDAE Center for Excellence in Basic Sciences. And besides my core competence, which is epigenetics, I take keen interest in educational research as well as creating gender equity beyond the binaries through community platforms. I volunteer my time as board member of the Hunsford Trust, and also I'm part of the ISRC, the Indian Scientists' Response to COVID-19, a group. Getting onto the topic, gender, as we all know, is an integral part of human sexuality, right? And it can simply be a part of our daily lives, not decided by us, but just declared right at birth, simply just by our chromosomes or the genitals we carry. So we step into this so-called a man's world with a predefined notion of gender. The conversations of how sexuality is layered on top of this gender is not often talked about in mainstream circles, particularly because I think sex has forever been a taboo subject in India. And ironic, in spite of which we are 1.3 billion people. So these problems are particularly evident in India, where we have dominantly patrilineal societies, that is, you know, inheritance is male-oriented, patriarchal regimes that interlace with caste as well as economic disparities. This popular phrase, ladki to parai dhan hai, is ingrained into our psyche. And this is normalized extensively by Bollywood. It's therefore not surprising to us that we see gender disparities and discrimination in almost all walks of life. So unless we make a conscious decision of waking up to these realities and having a conversation about it, we will never recognize the problem that is, and let alone finding solutions to it. So I think that today's discussion is a step towards that, and it is a part two of a series of discussions that we'll have been having. The major broad title is Invisible Hurdles That Is Faced in Social Justice in Indian Academia. And today we are going to focus on gender justice and sexual identities, and the roles that these have played in the past as well as in the present, and what learnings we can take forward from both of these and implementing that into our future. So, of course, this is a very vast topic and can be discussed from various angles. And to help bring out all these points and keep our discussion slightly focused, we have four good panelists today. We have Shubha Tole, we have Chainika Shah, we have Bittu Kaveri Rajaraman, and we have Sunil Mukhi. So I will introduce the panelists in a little more detail as we go along. Let me first bring in Professor Shubha Tole. Shubha received her PhD at Caltech and did her postdoctoral research at University of Chicago. She has been a TIFR as faculty for about 21 years now, and she has been a prolific neuroscience researcher and one of the most eloquent speakers that I have personally come across. So currently Shubha holds the Office of the Dean of Graduate Studies at TIFR, is chairperson of Women in Science of the Indian Academy of Sciences as well. So, Shubha, to initiate the discussion, today we are here to discuss these larger vagaries of gender. coming from a very larger space of the cisgender woman in science, having been on both sides of the aisle, both as a student as well as a faculty now for many years, could you share some of your experiences both in India and abroad, sort of compare and contrast these experiences where you see a large part of these disparities that we are trying to focus on, particularly in Indian science, which is highly male dominated? Shubha.
Hi everyone. Well, thanks for inviting me to join this team. This is a discussion I'm really looking forward to because I think it's a oft ignored issue, and we just haven't made progress in dealing with all of the invisible hurdles that that the sort of non-majority people face. The brief is fairly vast, Shubhajit. My experiences in India and abroad, and all of the issues. Maybe I just excerpt sort of one sort of angle on it, since our sort of subtopic is gender justice. I'd like to focus on the dozens and dozens of micro injustices that many people face just because people don't know how to with them or understand or communicate with anybody who is not exactly like them. So we're sort of contrasting the, you know, heteronormative male population. If I was in the US, I would have said white male, but in India, I guess brown male population with almost everybody else, at least for a start. I made two slides just to sort of tether my points. So I will to if you don't mind. To...
Yeah.
So we're talking about the dozens of daily micro injustices we face, right? And the first sort of sorry, I can't see what's being projected.
Can others see this? I don't know.
Yeah.
Yes, we can see.
Okay. So I guess I'm going to just guess. I hope you're seeing calm down.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I thought this might make a nice starting, how do you say it, phrase for what I want to say. Calm down. Okay. So if you could just click. I think this short little phrase is an extremely powerful weapon. And it's in fact one of the most powerful weapons a woman encounters daily. It's used against a woman who's simply making a point. Anytime you try and say something that's important to you, if it differs from what the listener is you know, trying to push, one easy way to control the situation is you tell the woman to calm down. Some people cannot see this slide. I guess that's only a few people. I suppose everybody's good.
Yeah, we can see
that's text, but the next one has a. Okay, this is sort of this weapon is insidious and diabolically powerful simply because it immediately puts the listener, the victim of this weapon. Sorry, there are messages popping up, I guess. Is there anything we can do? Because the next slide has a little more, has something on it.
I can click next if you want. Right now we are on a powerful weapon often used as a, against a woman.
No, I keep seeing messages popping up saying can't see the slide, but okay, I will just go. Okay. What happens when somebody says calm down? Okay. Immediately, the woman is in a position of saying, but I'm calm, I'm not angry. It takes the discussion away from the point that is being discussed to defending her state of mind. Okay, I've rarely ever heard a guy being asked to calm down. In fact, at my wonderful institute, the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, I have seen all kinds of very interesting behaviors displayed by men in faculty meetings. I can almost hear Sunil laughing here. I've seen men jumping up and down, shouting around. I've seen the young angry male phenotype, all of whom are broadly within a range of, okay, you know, aisa hota hai kabhi. And every time this happens, I keep thinking, now if that same behavior were displayed by a woman, oh my God, I mean, there's a very narrow range of behaviors a woman can display in order to be accepted. You have to fall in this category of likable and nice. And if you at all make a point, you get labeled in many, many ways, or then you get asked to calm down. If you can click once more.
If we don't question ourselves constantly, we eliminate any possibilities of progress.
Okay. Now, I don't want to speak for too long. I just want to say that these kinds of micro injustices to or against people who are not in the majority, people whom you're not familiar with, finally have huge impacts on their progress, their success, their careers. And in this lies in the space of, you know, you don't know what you don't know kind of thing. We're all steeped in our culture. We all grew up with surrounding biases, and we owe it to all of ourselves to question them. Because if we don't, here's what happens. Next, please.
Yes.
I'm going to showcase one study, which is, you know, which reveals a shocking sort of injustice in something as important to science as grants. Okay, this was a study published last year by Wittemann et al. They asked, are there gender gaps due to evaluations of grants, the evaluations of the applicant or the science? And this was a natural experiment, because what they did was they simply looked at about 24,000 grants that were submitted to the Canadian Institutes of Health Science Research. This is similar to our DBT, similar to the NIH in the US. And they were able to access an internally controlled experiment in some sense. If you click once, please. Because the Canadian Institutes of Health Research changed their grant patterns. They had the traditional programs before, in which it was just the grant and there was no explicit review or focus on the scientist who's being evaluated, whose grant is being evaluated. And then in 2014, they had bifurcated this into two streams, where the traditional grant pattern continued as a project grant program, where there's no explicit review of the scientist, and then a foundation grant program, where there is a component that explicitly focuses and reviews the scientist. So this was a completely, this was a pool of data that could be assessed and compared. And here's what they found when they looked at funding outcomes. If you can click, please.
Indeed.
The traditional programs, men and women, males and females, the funding projection was very close to each other, 15.4, 16.3%. If you looked at the new project grant programs, click please.
Yes.
Not too different again, 12.1, 12.9. And then finally, last click, where there is an explicit review focus on the scientist, the female percentages drop dramatically. Mm. Okay. Now, this is the last point I'm going to make. Again, connecting one's daily treatment of a group that you don't interact with on a regular basis, you have preconceived or implicit biases against, or you don't know how to fit them into your framework. This is what happens when you review them as scientists. You somehow deem that they are not as worth funding. So this is a broad spectrum to connect. But my point is that if one is in the mode of telling people to calm down simply because you don't understand them, or you don't know how to deal with their argument, or you find their argument makes you uncomfortable. If one finds oneself telling people not to be so sensitive, or, oh, it's only a joke, yeah, I submit that all of those biases build up to this, where in the end, at the end of the day, women get funded only 2/3 of the time compared to men. And this is huge. We can fix it by fixing the micro injustices. And let's start there.
That's really nice, Shubha. So, Shubha, these micro injustices that we are facing daily, you know, in these academic spaces, part of it also is coming from the whole sort of the we are a very male dominated sector of society. So, how is it that keep being a minority voice, being a minority in number as well in these larger spaces? How do you think that sort of do something in those spaces to change?
I couldn't hear that bit.
My question to you is that how do we build further on this? You say we need to start, we need to embalm some change, but how can we change given the fact that currently we are a very male-dominated scientific society? How can we start introducing those changes? What are your thoughts on that?
I'm sure the other speakers have oodles to say about this. I don't have anything new. We just need to be doing more of it. So I think maybe we can have this in the question session. Don't have one-shot solutions, but I would love to hear everybody else.
Sure. So maybe at this point, I'll bring Dr. Chainika Shah. And Dr. Chainika Shah has received her doctorate in physics, has taught physics to undergraduate students at K.J. Somaiya College of Science, Arts and Commerce, Mumbai, for about 2 decades. And she's a queer feminist, research activist, and has worked and written extensively on feminist studies and science, the politics of population control and reproductive technologies, communalism, and sexuality and sexual rights. She has also designed and co-taught postgraduate courses in science education and feminist science studies. Her co-authored books are No Outlaws in the Gender Galaxy, published by Zubaan, Bharat Ki Chhaap, a companion book for the documentary of the same name, and We and Our Fertility, The Politics of Technological Intervention. So, Shubha talks about this larger than that is the gender minority of women. And then, Chainika, I want to bring you in where you are dealing with a further layer of this then, which is also the sexuality, gender, and gender. So, Chainika, I'm talking to the larger populace from this gendered point, adding and this layer of sexuality, it is almost like we are talking to the we are from the fringe and we are talking to the center of to change this heteronormative mindset. So what are your understandings and how does this play a role in academia, the perceptions of these roles? How does it define the science we do and how does it define the questions that we ask? How does this play a role in science?
Thank you for having me here. I almost feel like an interloper in this panel also, and in science institutions per se, because science institutions have become symbol of people who are within research, are considered the science people, and many of us who've been teachers are in the hierarchy much below. But I thank Shubha to start with that calm down, because if as a woman you face calm down, then as an out feminist activist, you're not even heard, right? It's not even the starting point is somewhere very different. So it's really wonderful to have this chance to come and speak here with my understanding of being in education, being in science education, my long ago experience of being with these scientists, and years of looking at social science research as well. So to start, I would say that in principle, science has given access to everybody, right? In principle, there is access to everybody, but there is no accessibility. And I think that that's a very useful concept to keep in mind. And I'm sure that you'll hear much more of it when we speak of caste and when we speak of ability, because accessibility is not, I mean, maybe easier for the cis woman who comes from an urban English speaking background, from a Savarna background. Yes, accessibility is better for a person like me. Accessibility may be slightly better, but it, you know, as we look at various other margins, it gets worse and worse. And what we are learning from seeing from these marginalized positions, we see that while the space seems to be open to all, it is actually not for the brown male, Shubha, but it is a very particular kind of male that we're talking about. We're talking of an upper class, savarna, able-bodied, And I will add word cis het man from an urban background. I think that all of these and many of these layers you will unravel as you go through the series. We are going to concentrate today on gender and sexuality and look at that one layer, although I must also add that it's difficult to keep them separate. Difficult to keep the layers separate, but we'll try and look at the thing around gender and sexuality. The second point that I want to foreground is that while within science, we're still trying to, you know, address the question of women in science, the question of woman, who is a woman itself, has undergone a transition. The question of what is gender justice has evolved a lot in the last 40 years. We are still talking in terms of the questions that were asked from these various margins in the 80s. Today we are in 2020. Society is understood in much more complex ways, and so maybe we'll have to accelerate the discussion so that we don't, you know, do the chronological shift. Maybe we start in the present to see what can be done to make things different. So I in terms of gender and sexuality, I think that the question is of, you know, who is the scientist and what is the image of a scientist that is being constructed? What are the kinds of gender expressions that are allowed? And I'm sticking to science, although the larger title says Indian academia, but I'm going to speak only of the science academia. So what kind of gender expressions are allowed, especially for the cis man, is something that one has to think about. When gender expression itself is something that is so codified, which is something that we all recognize and bow down to, then we know what it means for somebody who is struggling to build that gender expression to be read in the manner that you would like, or you can read me, and to be here so that I am acceptable to you. And I'm, my urge for my kind of gender expression is not trivialized as something small, as something that can be done away with, as it's recognized as something critical to my existence. While that is necessary for those of us who are not going through that struggle to do, it is also important to recognize that anybody who is going through this everyday struggle, and I would say that women have gone through it earlier, maybe it's easier now, of how am I going to present myself? How am I going to pick myself? How am I going to speak of what I want to speak? That struggle itself takes a large part of your head and takes a large part of your life. And if you do not recognize that, then there is a flip question, which is, and this will come in different contexts for different people. Since we're speaking of gender and sexuality, I'm foregrounding that. That if we don't recognize that, and we keep on portraying science as a single-minded pursuit, that itself is going to put me off. That itself is going to make me feel that this is not possible for me, because I do not have the capacity, I do not have the freedom, I do not have the space, and I do not have the mind to be here in a single-minded pursuit. And so I think that the question of accessibility then becomes multi-layered, because does this enterprise seem like something that someone like me can enter into? Does this enterprise seem something that I can, you know, come to and be and find space within it? That's the larger question. The second question, apart from accessibility, the second question is, what is it that science is telling us as people from marginalized genders and sexualities? What does science tell us about our lives? Early on, lots of women went to science to settle the question of whether it is about the body or it is about society, right? We went looking to scientific, you know, material to justify that what the society is doing is not real, right? I knew that I can be equal, but to be certified equal, we looked at science. Science was not kind. science showed its biases, and there are multiple studies that we can talk about which show the biases that exist of what I'm calling that the center or the subject of science also. The person who is doing science is of a certain kind. The subject of science also has been visualized in the same frame. That you have not thought of a fact that the biological sex that is taken as so central to the making of a person may not be the thing that defines me, is not the thing that defines me. That there are different ways in which a person talks about themselves and talks about their beings. That there can be menstruation, what we can possibly talk about as scientists is menstruating bodies, is lactating bodies, is pregnant bodies, is semen producing bodies. That's not the language that we're still using. We're still using the language of the binary, and I think that binary then translates into many ways. And I just add my third point, which is that what has feminism of a long time told us about the way in which science has progressed? So one of the contributions of feminism is not only about talking about rights of women. Yes, it does talk about rights of women, but it goes much ahead. It goes much ahead to say how the understanding of gender, the patriarchal understanding of gender, constructs everything, constructs all knowledge systems. And one of the things that was highlighted was that there is this binary, the Descartesian binary that we all live with, which is of the objective, the subjective, the rational, the irrational, the culture, nature, public, private. And these are seen as qualities that are masculine and qualities that are feminine. Not only that, what is considered masculine is given more importance than what is considered feminine. And this is something that feminists pointed out to us. What queer feminists and what trans feminists are pointing out to us today is that this binary itself is a problem. That there is dividing the world into binaries is in itself a problem. And if I go to science scholars, science studies, feminist science studies scholars, they actually say that the question that we need to ask is, one, yes, what does it do to everybody who is not included? But a more critical question, maybe as scientists, that we need to ask is, what does it do to science itself to not have this reflecting in our practice of science? What does it do to science itself? That if we are understanding nature in these terms, if we understand our subject in these terms, if we understand our methods in these terms, then what does it mean for the practice of science itself? Does diversity, does bringing in, changing some of this, will it change our practice of science? This is an open-ended question which needs to be pursued, because what has been explained and what has been pointed time and again is that this pursuit that is going on right now has a certain mindset. And if we change that mindset, what will come out of it, we do not know. But it is worthwhile. It is worthwhile for the practice of science. And the many examples that we can see of that, the most interesting one being that, what does political action outside do to our understanding of science itself? And I keep remembering friends of mine pointing this out, that removal of homosexuality from DSM was not because of new evidence. It was because of pressure, political pressure. People were saying that our lives should not be medicalized, right? So there is always a response to the outside that science has, recognizing it, talking about it, talking about our processes differently, seems to be something that I would underline as a science educator. And that would be my final point, that what we are teaching right now is what is the final product of science. What we are learning is the final product of science. That is being made as the most important thing in science. The process of doing it is not something that we talk about. The context in which you do it is not what we talk about. The lives of people who do it, the accidents that make things happen, the debates that allow for certain ideas to emerge, all of that is not part of our learning of science. And I think it is not even a part of our understanding of science. And this COVID moment actually is telling us that unless we talk about science in the now and forever, in its social, cultural, economic, political, human context, it is not going to work. This is the moment when we are struggling to make sense of the world outside. If you take this moment, it's a wonderful example of how scientific methods get so rooted within the larger milieu and how they get translated also within the larger milieu. So I would say that the plea actually is for rethinking what is science and rethinking what is science education. Now, what are we doing is training in science. I think that from any lens we would come to this, but from the gender and sexuality lens in particular, the things to draw upon is whether the binaries need to be weighted in this manner. You know, some things are privileged and some things are not. And secondly, to think in terms of whether binaries is the way to go at all, if that is how the world is, or the world is very different from that. Thank you.
Very nice, Chanika, very nice. So this is a great sort of fulcrum for me to, so the idea that we are thinking in silos and therefore we are not able to think about how accessibilities are different for different people outside these silos, right? These binary silos that they create. And it's a great point for me to bring in Bittu right now, because Bittu Rajaraman, Bittu Rajaraman is an associate professor of biology and psychology at Ashoka, Ashoka University. Before this, he was an Inspired faculty at the Central University of Hyderabad. And before that, he was this DST Kothari postdoctoral fellow at the Center for Ecological Sciences, Indian Institute of Science. So Bittu received his PhD from Harvard University in neuroscience, studied intrinsic photosensitivity in salamander retinae. He's a genderqueer trans man and advocates the annihilation of caste, class, and gender. So Bittu, I think this is a great point for you to kind of come in, because so far when we have been talking about these larger lens, where the silos that we have created are male and female binaries, and you come from this completely different space now, where sexuality has to also be kind of brought into the picture of something that is invisible all along, right? A sexuality that has been invisible all along, a gender that has been invisible all along. So you come from a multi-layered part of this then within a then. So what have been your experiences in this whole interplay between gender and caste identity and inclusion? Do share some of your thoughts with us.
Okay, how much time should I take?
You can take a good 10 minutes or so.
Okay. All right, cool. I will try and do that. So if I had to pick sort of three major things to focus on, one would, I guess, have to be what it means to sort of be trans and sciences. That there's also a responsibility that I have in some sense to talk about this because, you know, every day, young trans scientists contact me. So students in the sciences who are not out as trans yet contact me, and we now have sort of a mentoring group consisting of about 30 students. But there are only a couple of us faculty who are trans, and so I feel like this is an important moment to make sure that each of those 30 students has a place that they can and feel completely comfortable being trans and doing science. And if we do not provide those environments, we're going to lose these students. I feel very much the same way. The second thing that I want to address is the ways in which gender intersects with caste, with class, with disability, and with region. And the reason I want to say this is because, you know, those factors make a massive difference between the gendered experiences of a person. Two people with the exact same gender will, you know, have, and even expression, will have very, very different trajectories depending to the science system, depending on these other factors they intersect. And the third thing, I guess, is I tell stories, mostly, you know, of other people, not mine, just to give you a sense, because I think that stories sometimes have a power to explain to people what sort of, you know, these challenges and these barriers look like on a day-to-day basis in a way that that really nothing else does. So I guess I will start quickly. So I'm going to try and do 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 3 minutes. So What does it mean when I say I'm trans? I guess I should begin with that because, you know, when I was at Harvard, my developmental biology professor, I sat next to him once at a dinner, and I was talking about animals, actually. And he said, wait, what is this? And I said, you're a professor of developmental biology. I mean, surely you know about the fact that most that several animals and plants and so on are not do not fall in the male and female categories. Several model organisms which are hermaphroditic. I mean, you know, there's just how could you not know? And he said, wait, are you saying this also happens among people? And I said, yes. I mean, I was just flabbergasted, right? And the reason I was flabbergasted is because you can be an expert in the subject, but if your eyes haven't been open to these questions, often by the people you meet, I mean, that's how our eyes get opened, right? That's the most powerful force that opens your eyes. You know, one can still just not be over things that are very much within the purview of textbooks. Now, I'll come later to what it is that needs to, which I think involves a lot of changing of textbooks, but among other things. But I will say, I will sort of therefore explain briefly what it means when I say I'm trans. And, you know, the standard sort of now legal definition of what it means to be trans is that identity gender you were assigned at birth, right? Now, what often tends to be complicated for people to parse is that the gender that's assigned to you is sort of it's a social category, right? And in some sense, one would expect every thinking individual to be uncomfortable with any gender that's assigned to them, right, at birth. And so at some level, so when I say I'm genderqueer, for example, what I mean by that is that I question these categories, right? As Chanika said, I question the fact that these categories exist, that there's any basis to them. I mean, I admit that, the distribution of sort of chromosomes, for example, of XYXX chromosomes is bimodal, although by no means sort of categorically separable into these male and female categories. But I do not think that the mapping of social categories to bodies, right? I mean, I think that mapping is quite arbitrary, and we will never really know how arbitrary unless we do the social experiments of actually seeing whether you can provide very, very similar environments to people of all genders and then see what happens as a consequence, right? In fact, what's quite striking are some of the ways in which these possibilities have not been explored, even in sort of science in 2020, which is so sort of technologically advanced, but still isn't asking some questions that need to be asked, right? So for example, remember that a lot of this also reflects on what it means to be a scientist and what science was, 50 years ago and what it is now. So I will get to science itself in a minute, but for me, when I say I'm trans, I do not just mean that I'm uncomfortable with the particular gendered category that was assigned to me. I also mean that I, and perhaps this is, this is how I relate my understanding of the world as a scientist with that, and this is my training and experience. In fact, is that me being trans is about not identifying or not sort of having a body somatosensory input to my brain from what my brain expects. Now, if you find that a bit of a mouthful, what I've all to do in, of course, it's more fun really interacting to face like what you do this. But if you like close your eyes and put your hand out in front of you, right? So try that. If your eyes are closed, some sense of your hand, right? You know that your hand in front of you, you know that it's there. In some sense, your somatosensory perception, right? Your chest is connected to your upper arm, and that's connected to your forearm, and you have a sense of how it is that these different body parts are touching each other and interacting with each other, right? For me, the physical experience of being is in consonant their soul gender discomfort. And so it's not. For me, that physical experience, one of having an unexpected input from my body in some compared to what my brain expects to be. Now, if you were to imagine the phantom limb phenomenon where people feel they have an arm which may have moved, right? That's kind of mismatch. Somebody who may have, suppose tomorrow you were to wake up with an extra limb onto your front, right? Your brain is not expecting somatosensory input, and yet, right? Suppose that would be an example of the physical sense that I feel. And then to understand this might work with so much degree, you have to then imagine that when you're alone at home with this extra limb that has been glommed onto your body, you're still thinking about it, right? You don't want to be thinking about it, but you're thinking about it because there it is, regularly violating your expectations of what your body is like. And, you know, it's, you can't ignore it. It's right there in front of you all the time. And the social experience in some sense is what happens when you then leave that room and go outdoors. And then something which you're trying not to think about, you're stuck with this arm that is glommed onto your body now, and you are trying not to think about it, and everybody who sees you says, what is that? Kya ho raha hai? Tumko kya ho gaya? What's going on? Why is it this way? You know, and this is the gap that people with disability, especially with visible disabilities, have to deal with all the time, right? Is that even very well-meaning people are just constantly asking the question. And that then brings to the fore what we call dysphoria, right? That discomfort with this sort of body part that feels like it shouldn't be there in terms of your brain's expectation of your body is now also a site for social scrutiny. And then on top of that, if the entire way that you're supposed to behave, right, which is gender, right, if the entire way you're supposed to behave is dictated by whether you have this arm glommed or not, then it becomes even more of a problem. So in some sense, this is what the experience of being trans is for me. And there are several people, several scientists, shall I say, who are trans, who find it difficult to operate simply because one is either constantly thinking about, or you know, one's attention is being diverted to these, to sort of this this disconnect between one's body and one's brain's perception of that body, or one's attention is being directed to it by other people, or other people are looking at that arm and saying, "Oh, you have this arm glommed onto your body. Now you can't do science, right? Or now I don't expect you to do science." Or, I mean, you're transgender, so I mean, that must mean that you're going to have to live some kind of impossibly difficult life, which would not involve being in the sciences, right? This is not what we expect you to be. So that's, in some sense, that experience. And of course, you know, as a trans scientist, there are particular challenges. You know, one's publication history is in one set of names, you know. and if one is then, if one transitions to using a different name and a different pronoun, very often it looks like you have, you know, half and half a CV because you're just, it's just two different names, two different people, right? People don't think of these as the same, and they won't think of you as the same as what you were before because you're then referred to by names and pronouns that you do not anymore identify with. And so, you know, I also just want to add one more thing, which is that I'm really glad that trans issues are being brought up in the context of gender and science and gender in general in this country. And the reason I say that is because, you know, I've lived in the US and here, and I feel like in many ways the transphobia I encountered in the US was far worse than what I encountered here. And we also see this cropping up in terms of the kinds of feminisms that people do. So, for example, in British, one finds a lot of sort of trans exclusionary discourse, which one simply does not find in Indian feminism. And so even though not really people who think of ourselves as a country that can sort of really show the world what is possible in terms of trans inclusion, in fact, we are one of the countries with the most historically organized trans communities. And that has pushed the discourse here in ways that it hasn't in most parts of the world. And so I'm hoping that this is a space where we really teach the world how talking about gender with respect to academia, but also in general, is going to be a trans-inclusive thing. Okay, so that's part one, and it's already run as it often does. So I'll skip the stories and stick to them for the question and answer sessions where I'm hoping lots of people ask interesting questions. But I'll make one more point about gender more broadly, which is not about being trans, and what I think should be done to change the current system, which privileges you know, cis, hetero, you know, patriarchal voices, upper caste voices, able-bodied voices, and upper-class voices. So the reason that I mention all of these other categories is because, you know, in my time, for example, at the University of Hyderabad, I had, when I around the time that I was leaving the University of Hyderabad, I wrote an article as part of a series in the EPW in which Janika had also written about gender and science. And in that I had co-authored with two students who each spoke from the perspective of being one student, the perspective of being Dalit, and the other student spoke from the perspective of being Adivasi. Now it's important to bear in mind that I'm really glad that this series is taking on caste, in another forum. But what often tends to happen is that, the panels that address gender, including this one, tend to be all Savarna. The panels that address caste tend to be largely male. And the voices of Dalit and Adivasi women, in particular, tend to slip between the cracks. And, you know, at this stage, the system is so strongly biased against, Dalit and Adi in academia, but especially Dalit and Adivasi women, that the people who I have met, who have made it through this incredible set of double barriers, are just so bright that it breaks your heart and makes you incredibly angry that these are the people we're keeping out of academia, right? So I'd encourage people to read that piece as well, because I realized that several things. So for example, I have seen male professors pick on students who are women students from Dalit and Adivasi backgrounds to harass, because they know that it will be that much harder for this person to file a case against them. And in fact, just to even go up against them, right? Where are the caste networks with which they will counter you and survive? You'll have Savarna students who come out of the lab, women students saying this professor was great and fine. And so I no longer, based on my interactions with men, give them tapas saying, you know, I think this person is great to work with. I tell everybody, you don't know what someone is like to work with unless you actually work with them. And unless you really talk to people who come from a variety of marginalizations and work with them. Because, you know, people who have sexually harassed students in their fifth year so that they will not be able to leave at that stage, or fifth year of a PhD, people, who have, and sexual harassment is really the tip of the iceberg, right? What doesn't get discussed and for which there are no institutional mechanisms is the huge amount of gender discrimination, right? Which is five people are in a room, two women, two men, and everybody, sometimes including the women, are all addressing the oldest man in the room when they speak and not one another equal, right? That's just sort of the small tip of the iceberg. It's any number of people being unwilling to accept the authority of women in science, questioning them. I also have to say that as a trans person in science, I've probably been faced various kinds of harassment much later in my career than women typically would, because, it's sort of assumed that, A, just by being trans, I'm somehow opening myself up to being sexual. that sort of just comes as a package, part of my identitarian package. And B, it's assumed that, this person is not protected by kind of the caste. There's a halo of protection around Savarna women in particular, which is not extended to Dalit Adivasi women, and which is not extended to women with disabilities, and is not extended to trans persons. I mean, it's considered doing something with these people or trying something. If I wanted to try something, then this is the person to try with. Right? These are sort of gutted people anyway, and who's going to believe them? So there is also that whole package of things. I went to grad school at Harvard, which was really the first place that I myself, with all my privileges of being myself from a privileged caste and class background, having academic parents, all of that gave me so much confidence. And I didn't understand what it meant for an institution to destroy confidence and to really implement sexism until I went to Harvard, which was, of course, notorious for its sexism. And mercifully, about halfway through my grad school tenure there, an environment in which, women faculty were routinely called bitches by graduate students. All of the bathrooms, of course, still had urinals from when it was an all-male institution. In such an environment, when Larry Summers said women can't do science, it was a terrible thing, but it was wonderful for the institution, because finally all of these sexist practices, came under some scrutiny and things started to change there and have improved greatly since. But I would also encourage everybody who's listening to this to go and listen to the debate that happened in Harvard after that, where, Steven Pinker took up, Larry Summers' sort of cudgels, and, this was the brave sentiment that men dare not voice, that women just may not be able to do science, you know, and so they consider themselves, you know, these people who were struggling to, you know, to make sure that this truth got out there. And he was countered by, you know, the person who debated opposite him was Elizabeth Spelke. And I think she did a fabulous job of questioning all of his assumptions. And, you know, it's just incredible that, you know, if you were a scientist 100 years ago, you would say, look, you know, there is just the facts speak for themselves. Men just don't do as well in IQ tests as women. That's it. Right? I mean, there's nothing I can do about it. This is just fact. And you, unless you start questioning who is doing science and why and with what agenda, and counterposing, not necessarily people with the opposite bias, but just people who are asking the questions to which they find unbiased answers in the data, you simply don't explore counterfactual possibilities. So now, with some degree of change in the socialization of men and women, one finds that the data tell you that you know, women and men do, depending on the mode of examination, equally, slightly better or slightly worse. And in Indian boards, actually, women tend to slightly outperform men at the top end of things, and that's also true for Singapore's testing system, whereas the SATs in the US continue to preserve a male edge. But, you know, the famed kind of socials, the sort of disparity in spatial skills, which Larry Summers referred to, was challenged only in 2007, right? 2007 was when a study was done looking at whether playing video games eased or equalized one remaining disparity in IQ tests between men and women. And lo and behold, 8 hours of video game training improved everybody's scores and narrowed the gap between men and women. Right? So when one's saying equal socialization, one is not saying just give both people access to a textbook. One is saying everything must be equal, including video game playing, right? And it's not unless one conducts that experiment of really equalizing access. And in fact, somebody had mentioned in the comments this question about whether women are less daring than men. And Liz Felke's work does this, does a beautiful job of showing that babies, you know, whose videos are shown to parents, and they're told this baby is a boy, this baby is a girl, it's the same baby, same video, right? But if parents are told, or if adults are told, this is a video of a boy sort of navigating a slope, versus a girl navigating a slope. When the boy is it, you know, this is a tiny infant, you know, just able to walk. The adults say, oh my God, this boy is so brave. He's trying so hard. You know, he's just about to get over the slope. And the girl, they say, no, be careful, watch out. She shouldn't go there, right? And so even out of concern, parents may be providing the same inputs to children, expecting them to be timid, expecting them to be brave and so on, based on a cursory examination of usually their bodies. So I will end there. I will just say that there's also a unique perspective that trans people can bring to the sciences. For example, Ben Barres, who transitioned and talked about how you know, people referred to his publications before he transitioned to being a trans man, saying, oh, you know, that guy must have been your sister, you know, you must have written the paper for her. And so, you know, we also, for example, if I pass as a woman, I get certain kinds of protections. People are always binarizing, putting you into various compartments. But if I pass as male, then I get other kinds of protections. And occasionally I hear all kinds of, you know, talk usually meant for the cis male circle, and then I faithfully betray them and relate to my feminist peers. So we also have some jassoosy skills as trans people that we can which we can render service to feminism. I hope to the overall cause of having a world in which potentially gender can be annihilated and people can just be themselves and be socialized similarly. So I'll stop there, and I will just say that one needs to, therefore, there is no way that one can provide these equal environments without equivalent socialization across castes, classes, and genders. That means equivalent care work, equivalent expectations, and we are going to have to address the scientific norms that underpin a lot of this sexism, including this understanding of what men, what it is thought to, you know, women can do, and so on and so forth, much of which is still based on a host of sort of untested assumptions. Thank you.
Wonderful. I'm really glad that I'm actually very envious of your students, Bittu. They have such nice. You really spoke very well about, and you brought out the layers, all these layers amazingly well. You put them together. I think that brings you to sort of address this gendered experience that we're talking about, right? We are talking about, and the moment we talk about gender, to the larger populace, a lot of people immediately dissociated of it. I love the example that you gave me, the hand in front of you, right? We know this hand is connected to the body. So yeah. I know that this gendered experience is mine. But the moment this, when I talk about gender disparities, when I talk about gender inequalities, people tend to other the gender, right? They, oh, it's not my problem, it's somebody else's problem, and therefore I don't need to worry about it, I don't need to think about it. And but yet, and then there's also the male gender, right? So there are gendered questions there as well. And I think this is a good point to bring in Sunil at this point too, because Professor Sunil Mukhi is a professor of theoretical physics at ISER Pune. He is a former dean of graduate studies, chair of Department of Theoretical Physics at TIFR, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, and also former dean, student activities chair, and chair physics department at ISER Pune. So has had an extensive experience, and probably the most expensive on this panel, both within and outside these administrative responsibilities. He has become aware of how subtle and non-subtle institutionalized discrimination against women and sexual minorities plays out in academia. Currently, Professor Sunil Mukhi is the chair on the panel of scientific values of the Indian Academy of Sciences. So, Sunil, I would like you to take the dais and essentially take the conversation forward into how you think that these explicit biases and these play out in academic conversation, and how do implicit biases play a role when we are having these academic conversations within science and the larger academia in general.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Subhajit. You know, I don't normally feel nervous in seminar giving talks or web talks, but today I really do, because I think I don't have anything like the kind of experience that the other three panelists have brought and have expressed. And I'm not sure I have some sort of coherent picture to present, but I'll present two things which are sort of uppermost in my mind these days. One is that, you know, there's everything that's been said is obviously is true, and much of it is very disturbing and needs correction. So, you know, how are things to be corrected? That's really the question. Well, that's not really the only question, but it's a question, a very important one. You know, how can we say that, you know, 5 years from now, things should be better in academia than they are now? Or are things today better than they were 5 years ago? And here I see two things. These are just stray comments. One is that, you know, ever since at least I became an adult, which is very long ago in the 70s, early 70s, there was a sense that, you know, traditional society is facing the challenge of modernity, and that both India and the world at large progressing in some forward direction, becoming more liberal, more tolerant, more inclusive, more everything. Maybe it's slow, maybe it's not perfect, definitely it's not perfect, but the direction of movement seemed unambiguously forward in the 70s. Now, I think I probably speak for even for the other panelists now when I say that, you know, in 2020 or even a few years ago or even 10 years ago, it didn't seem like that anymore. Now, it's a disturbing sense that for every forward movement, there's an equal and opposite or stronger backward movement. And that there are, you know, forces much stronger than those of a few intellectuals of liberal persuasion talking over on a webinar, which don't actually subscribe to core concepts like human rights, and which see other things as more important. And, you know, it's important to understand that there are people, there are very many people, it's not only India, it's not only any one country, who believe that, you know, the concept of human rights per se is overblown and oversold, and, you know, it's more important for society to have strong leaders and every country be angry with every other and everything be sort of somewhat militarized and socialized in a proper, in a formal, in a framework where everybody has their place. And well, if that place isn't good, that's just too bad. I think if we don't mention the fact that this is an active and existing ideology, then we are in danger of feeling that, you know, our piously held views that society can get better are in danger of just being views and not getting anywhere. And it's a real worry because, you know, I feel, you know, I'm at the end of, towards the end of my career, literally a formal career, but it's certainly not what I thought. It doesn't seem like what I thought I signed on to science for, you know, 3 decades ago. And yet now, so that's the negative. And yet, even taking on board, I mean, and certainly taking on board everything that the other panelists have said, I think it's fair to say that the discourse around women, trans people, and LGBTQ people in academia is more in quantity and quality now than it would have been 20 years ago. And essentially 20 years ago, there was close to nothing. 40 years ago, there was essentially nothing. So something has changed for the better, but it looks like we have to work not just against the stasis of society, but against active forces which are trying to push the other way. You know, I used to think that we have to plow a path through a very static, very conservative society, and we have to force our way like through a viscous medium. But I think now it's not so much a viscous medium as a medium which has a flow the other way. And so we have to create a counterflow. So this is a slightly negative point I want to raise, because I think people should take it on board. Now, counterbalancing that, you know, as I've told you, I moved to ICER Pune 8 years ago, and I here we have, you know, 1,500 students on campus. This is not like TIFR at all. It doesn't feel like TIFR. It doesn't look like TIFR. And one thing new, and these students, you know, join us when they are 18 or 17 in some cases. So they're really young. And one thing that I learned is that, you know, while people like me of my age are sitting around worrying and wondering how we can improve things and so on, these kids, many of them are not asking anyone any questions or asking for any favors or anything. They're just going ahead and making sure that society changes. So, for example, ICER students, with no help that I know of from any senior person, started an LGBTQ group. It's active and functioning in the campus. Not just that, they've had plays, street plays, during festivals. They've had, you know, many, not just one, but many panel discussions on themes, again, related around LGBTQ and around women in science. And there are regularly seminars, activities, and so on. Now, the point I'm trying to emphasize is they're doing all this without any, without anyone telling them they should or they shouldn't. I'm happy to say ICER is I see ICER Pune as a highly liberal campus, and one where everyone knows that we are supportive, but it's not necessary that students have to come and take support if they don't feel the need. In fact, all the better if they don't feel the need and they think they can create groups where they welcome each other, safe spaces where they talk to each other, and faculty aren't even involved. So I think that's a good sign. And, you know, seeing these people on this campus has partly relieved my pessimism about the way society is going. It's like, where do these kids come from if society is going backwards? And they are not, and by the way, they really are not overwhelmingly upper class, and certainly not overwhelmingly male. I think we have it's not a great proportion, but maybe 1/3 of our students, maybe more, are female. And it seems like the lead is being taken by students who essentially decided that they want to be leaders in how society is supposed to be, and they're not going to take crap from anybody. I think that's just wonderful. And personally, I certainly would like to support that as much as I can. So these are just 2 points I wanted to make. I realize it doesn't come from any deep expertise, but this is just what I'm seeing at my age in my place. You're muted, Shubhajit. Yeah.
Yeah. So Sunil, there was one question on the group which I thought both you and Shubha can probably take. And let me just pull up that question. There's Shwetambara, who's asking that the onus for dismantling or even questioning these binaries, these gender minority and associated problems, these binaries, lies on whom? So is those who are able to fit within these binaries, or those who don't fit within these binaries? Particularly, you and Shubha are from the mainstream academia, you know, I want you to sort of think about and answer this question. How do we look at this?
I can't resist saying, you know, this question is posed in binary language. Those who are able to fit within the binary for those. You know, we are always in binary because you know these things about binary. Anyway, of course, you know, there's no onus. The point is that the binaries are not being dismantled by people who run society by and large. They're not into dismantling binaries. They're not trying. They don't want it. And as I said, I think a lot of society is in the pushback mode where dismantling binaries is a bad thing. Witness in the US or places, suddenly for the last few years, transgender toilet for whatever reason has become an issue, as though somehow this is an insoluble issue for the world's most advanced country. So it's not like everyone is trying to dismantle binaries. Now, among those who are trying, there are those who are non-binary, those who are binary, but I really don't see any problem in these two getting together, because these two are on the same side. It's not about where they personally fit, it's about what they believe should happen for a better society. And here I can refer to what Chenika said earlier, which is, you know, she brought up repeatedly, what do we think science will be when we stop restricting it to the kind of people that it currently has? And all the discourse that I know of and all the studies I know of on such questions seem to suggest that it'll only be better. The more diverse it is, the better it is. This is also, you know, why, I mean, the US knows this. This is why Silicon Valley, which is more powerful than most countries of the world, is made up of people, Chinese, Indians, people from all over, Pakistanis, people from everywhere. They really know that this diversity makes them better, not that they are great at diversity, they have their own gender issues and all that. But in general, that diversity is better is something, you know, there's no serious debate on the other side that I know of.
Shubha, would you like to add something?
No, I think that was very, very well said. I'd like to address one of the other questions when you come to it.
Why don't you go ahead? Tell me which one. Go ahead.
There's a question from Shalini Sharma. Does our curriculum include publications from other people of color, scientists of different genders? What efforts are made to encourage students to probe into the background of those they read? I actually believe the sort of sociology within which science occurs is actually important. It's more than just the paper and the data. It's the life story of the scientist who, you know, went through this or that and then finally took this problem on and then interacted with so and so. So it's these stories of how the science came about. So we make it a point to, so my students have not traveled as much as I have yet, but whenever possible, I interrupt the flow of a journal club with saying what I know about the scientist, the context, maybe something you know, non-scientific I might know about them that fleshes them out and makes them a real person. And obviously we do this for the spectrum of people that I happen to have interacted with, which I try and make as wide as possible. And I somehow think this is important. I think it's important to, you know, the backstories to the extent one knows them. It's easier, I must say, to identify people who appear in name. Let's just say that way. Or people in India, one can recognize mostly female names. But beyond that, unless somebody has actually come out as a member of one of the LGBTQ spectrum, it's difficult to know and to sort of consciously include studies or papers by a wider spectrum of people. But I think it's important. I think it's important to know who the person is and how they got to where they are. So I hope that answers it in some way.
Thanks, Shubha. Chenika, there's a comment actually, but I would like you to expand on that because I think it's a very important, poignant point that you also made earlier. Chenika made a very perspective point that science is primarily being taught, learned, and experienced as a product. It's high time we interrogated the context and process of science as well. So Chenika, I think this is a very I'd like to you to elaborate on this point as to how are we going to, what kind of checks and balances can be added to the system going forward, where we can address these a little more, put these more into place, these kind of issues.
So actually, I'll connect it with what the earlier question that Shubha addressed. Mm-hmm. The problem is that there is no way for me to know that a Mukhi is, who is this person, right? There is no mechanism by which I can find this out. And this is part of our complete structure. So I'm not saying, yes, you can add some things in the journals. Yes, you can add some things in the journal clubs. But till I start thinking that it is important for me to know that in what context did this person reach here, it is a different understanding that I get about how science is being done. And I speak from my experience. I mean, one of the reasons why I gave up research in theory physics is because I could not make the match between what I was doing as part of my research and what was troubling me about the world outside. And even though, as Sunil says, those were times, and this is the late 70s and early 80s, that those were times when we were much more positive about the world. We felt that there was a lot that needed to be changed. We felt that there was a lot that needed to be different. We felt more optimistic then, maybe, than what we feel today. But the need for change has been felt all along. And there was no way that I could see myself bringing these two worlds together. And so I chose to teach, and this concern of my engagement with science continues till date. When I choose to do what are now being called science studies. And I think that this separation of science and science studies, that the educators will do science studies or the social scientists will do science studies and the real natural scientists will do science. I think that each of these terms I want to put in quotes and question. So I do think that checks and balances are important in the now, but in the long run, I feel almost impatient with this. If we talk of, we say, okay, we'll bring in history of science into our textbooks. So if we go back to school, they all put in boxes. And what is the history that we're telling? We're telling the history of this person. And I've looked at NCERT textbooks recently. Those are the best that we have. That this person came from a royal family. This person was fala, fala, fala. And that's about it. That doesn't tell me anything. That doesn't tell me that not one active debate of the past has been taught. Not one active, something that has been resolved now. Can I hear it? Can I hear that debate to be able to understand what is the method of science? So I spoke and learned and thought much more about the method of science when I moved out of active science research. When I came to social science and I understood this engagement with the method, that I feel that this kind of blind following of, that we think that we know because I've done experiments in the lab, because I've done some equation solving, some kind of computation, that I know that this is the method of science. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about understanding why. Why did this, and to even answer the question that Sunil raised, that this pressure that we're feeling of, everything that we thought was moving forward is being pushed back by both progressive and regressive forces. It's not only by the people who are anti-science that we're getting a push. There are people who are critical of science, who are very much pro-science, but are critical of science. If we imagine that push to be from the same direction or in a similar manner, then we are losing the battle. Because it is from within that the critique has to happen. It is from within that these questions have to be raised. So binary, non-binary, it is actually the ones who benefit from the system. I feel that the onus is on them, that the onus of seeing what that benefit is, the onus of seeing how the structure keeps these benefits intact and dismantling it bit by bit, relooking at it bit by bit, is something that we need to do. And I totally, would like to add one point that Bittu had raised, that it is about, so any kind of institutional work, any kind of teaching is seen as taking me away from science. I think I find it extremely difficult to understand what is this great science that you're going to do if you're not going to include everything else that allows me to do this science. That there is a whole lot of, you know, work that your administrative staff, your lab staff, your everybody, even the person who comes and cleans your lab every day, they are contributing to this, you know, absolutely refined, rarefied atmosphere. And of course, I keep TFR in front of me as I speak of this, that space itself, where the best science can happen, it automatically is shifting the, you know, if I can't be comfortable in that space, if I feel out of place in that space, it is not for me to do good science. What I will do will always be in the margins of science. And I think that these fundamental definitions need to shift. And that's why I say I think that the debates have shifted. Maybe we should start with the present times. And so I also again think that, you know, not looking at gender in the binary anymore. I mean, that was done in the 80s, we've done with it. Today we are talking of gender in more complex terms. And let's understand it, whether it is complexity in terms of how I understand my own all the other things around me, these are the debates that we need to address. So we have to accelerate from the question of women in science to the question on what do we as scientists feel about science, education, and institutions, all three.
You're muted.
Shobhajit, I have a question for my co-panelists or anybody in the audience. May I?
Sure. So, but can I before you do, Bittu wanted to make a point.
I think that people, that because there's an international discourse around gender, people don't disagree that there should, on the principle of gender diversity, even though their practical implication of it can often lag far behind this sort of theoretical agreement. But I don't think the same is true of caste. I think caste being an India-specific phenomenon ends up, it continues to be one of those phenomena where there's really active sabotage, I think, of Dalit and Adivasi faculty, let alone Dalit, and of course, Dalit and Adivasi students. Was stymied in the act of doing science, right? He was told you can't do science. And this is ridiculous. Everyone can do science, right? I mean, I think our point as scientists is that we're proud of being part of a methodological tradition that does not uphold figures of authority based on their authority. We are here to tear down structures of authority, right? We're here to say the only thing that matters is evidence. But it's also then important for us to question what happens as evidence today. As I said, a scientist 100 years ago could say, look, the evidence says that men are smarter than women, right? And in sort of regular, school testing. And that's not the case today because social structures have pushed where science is at. Social structures have changed the facts that are now in admission before us. And so we have to apply that standard when we're questioning today's evidentiary standards. We all, including me, are part of institutions in which our testing structures to decide who comes into the institution to do science are fundamentally based on an extremely unequal access to language. We all know, I mean, certainly as neuroscientists, everybody knows this in a commonsensical way, but we certainly know the neural basis of what it means to be exposed to one language much later in life than another language. And then if you're tested in that language, and we're still mostly testing in English across the board, you know, you're just going to weed out incredibly smart people from across the population. And then even this idea that you can reduce all kinds of diverse abilities down to testing scores, you know, these are all things that gate who is able to reach us, even if we have interview panels, right? Who gets to the interview panel? Who gets past school, right? Who has the financial ability to get through school, right? So we are, you know, our science is this very thin, whatever we do within science at the level of sort of trying to sort of, even in terms of implementing, you know, various forms of affirmative action in schools and colleges, it's a thin veneer on top of an incredibly unequal society. And so I think that the only way that we're really going to see gendered equality is if we really, tackle head on these structures of caste and class and gender from a very, very young age. And unless we are in a position to do that, right, we're not going to be in a position to sort of change the facts that are under admission today, right? And the only thing we can do as scientists until that sort of larger social experiment and necessary social experiment happens is to interrogate our facts, interrogate what questions we're asking and what we're assuming without actually having tested those things. Yeah.
Shubha, you had a question for the panelists.
Oh, extremely well said, Bittu. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, okay, my question to all three of you, actually, or anybody in the audience, picks up from a comment by Nandita Jayaraj. Hi, Nandita. She talks about, you know, there's more than just cis women missing from MANLs, right? We keep calling out MANLs, but we need to expand them beyond just, you know, just adding more cis women to them. How do we do this? So my question is this, okay, here is something that we may be in a position to actually do. It so happens I currently chair the Women in Science Committee of the Indian Academy of Sciences. More than a decade ago, Rohini Godbole started a database of women scientists in India. We have discussed and agreed that we are going to revive and make this database current, but we want to do more than the database. And here is where I would like input. Okay, I envision a database where we have women students, postdocs, research faculty, people who have been in science and are now doing activities that are not precisely research, but maybe teaching, maybe, you know, branched out from science industry. We also want people who have never been in science but can speak to and inform the practice of science, science education, the sociology of science, even people in the legal system. So if we had all of these people available, then wouldn't institutions have a fantastic resource to run workshops and educate and broaden all our minds? Every time you have a conference and, you know, you want to have a panel discussion on current issues, you have a resource of people who are not just, you know, okay, student, postdoc, faculty member, but people who have branched out or people who've never touched, you know, gone through science themselves, but now are studying, you know, the practice of it and so on. So this is the kind of, and we envision not only having this for Indian residents or citizens, but also anybody from outside India who would like to be part of this database. Basically, we want it to be a resource so that institutions can have access to experts of varying kinds, so that, you know, we should do more than just have scientific seminars. So my question is, how do we expand this database, okay, to have more than cis women there? Okay, I mean, how do we do this? Already as Dean of Graduate Studies, I'm collecting male-female statistics of all our admissions procedures. And yes, I periodically pause and sob. And I have three columns, male, female, and other, as often we see on government forms and so on. But, you know, right now we're relying on people to self-declare. So my quandary is this: how do we A, create a database? B, is it even reasonable to ask people who are not in the majority to stand up and be counted, and then they get labeled as just that? I mean, sometimes I wonder, you know, I would really like to be invited to be something, to be invited for something just for the science and not because I'm a woman scientist, you know? So, it pulls in two directions, right? The minute you're part of a database. So it's a mixed, messy question, but I would really welcome input because here's something we can actually do. We are doing, okay? And I'd like to acknowledge Shruti Muralidhar, who's a postdoc at Harvard, who's helping me with this database. So if she's out there, thank you.
Wonderful. Sure, panelists.
Okay, I might want to jump in really quickly to say, in general, I really welcome this. Firstly, in general, there have been so many times when there have been sort of women in science type lunches at conferences and so on, and I sort of kind of gone and hung around awkwardly, you know, in the back, thinking like, oh man, I'm not a woman, but you know, these are the people whom I can bond with here, right? I mean, absolutely. I'm experiencing the same kind of toxic masculinity in scientific spaces. I'd like to share that with somebody, and I'd like not to have to be in my own category by myself for an internal monologue. So I think certainly it would be useful for the question of gender and science to be a question of gender and science rather than women in science. I would broadly advocate that we just change those titles of panels to gender and yourself, with an understanding that it's that these will be focused on the on people who face oppression around gender, right? That the majority of speakers will be women and trans people.
So you want my first task as the chair of the committee to change the name of the committee itself?
Yes, ideally. And you know, I especially say that as somebody who's sort of on the trans masculine spectrum, you know, because I think we sort of especially get often left out of the discourse around women. Although, again, as I've said, I'm really thrilled that feminist circles and women's circles in India have become more and more, and many of them have already been sort of trans inclusive of trans women from the get-go. This question of identification is particularly fraught. And I think it applies to trans people, but also, for that matter, to people, you know, from oppressed castes, and especially, I think, to people from oppressed castes. And the reason is that once one is sort of publicly identified as such, one knows one's opening oneself up to a whole host of sort of weird things, right? So there's outright discrimination, which is rare, especially in India. In India, people will come up to you, they'll say nice things to your face and so on, and then they'll go away, and you know people are saying really bizarre things behind your back, right? Or they will say nice things, but they don't want you near them or around them, or, you know, messing up their, you know, they don't want to hire you, you know, I mean, they don't want to have somebody who's a who's just by virtue of, and of course, you know, in my case, it becomes difficult to segregate this from other kinds of political activism, but they don't want to have a troublemaker in their midst, you know, so you know, one faces sort of straight exclusions, which one doesn't even know where they come from, so I understand that this question of self-identification is tough, but I would submit that for those who do want self, the categories of may be somewhat limiting, because and maybe example, persons who identify as female. So I think that helps to say, to have a box of, either have an intersecting box of male, female, other, and are you trans, yes or no? Or one can have trans man, trans woman, you know, sexist woman, and just male, female for those who don't specify whether they are trans or cis or not. And that helps. But there's a whole host of sort of non-binary identities. So what I often prefer is for people to just leave it blank and let people fill in what gender they identify as. And then one can still sort of do a clustering and, you know, group together identities which one thinks would correspond to people who face marginalization.
I'll talk to you offline because see, you want this to be searchable. So you can't have people put in too many creative options.
True, but if many of those creative options map onto a single or map onto sort of the same, so if someone says woman, someone says female, you know, one can, I find one still is able to kind of map these, and one can also provide kind of restricted options. I mean, these are the various options, but I would welcome that very strongly, and I think for people who would like to take up the issues of intersections of, say, disability, and, you know, because I mean, in the field of neuroscience and psychology, several faculty are stuck having to teach kind of material that is so horribly ableist, right? Okay, let's take something which is very common in the scientific community, right? Very large numbers of people in the scientific community identify on the autistic spectrum, right? Despite that, one has so many sort of talks about autism, so many discussions that are so ableist in terms of how they just the framework that they come from, right? The words that I use, disorders and so on and so forth. So I think that that as trans people who, you know, were have historically been clubbed together with the disabled, the disordered, and so on, that we fight for all sort of categories of disorder to kind of be interrupted and interrogated. So I think that it would be useful to also explain this to people to identify along other axes of marginalization if they would like to. And of course, it's completely understandable that most people don't. And I still find it very hard to find people who would want to talk about both of these things. And I'm really glad you're extending it to students, because I think it is students who are being in many ways braver than our generations. Many people are just sort of fearlessly going where no one has gone before.
Absolutely.
And
I think it's silly to leave students out. They're the future.
Absolutely.
Leave them out of databases. How will they ever want to be in one later?
That's right. Another possibility is also to for some of these things around being trans or around being around caste specifically, I think it would be valuable to have mentoring networks that are not public. So then you know, even if people don't want to publicly disclose themselves or Dalit or Adivasi in, you know, in on a public database, that if they wanted to sign up for a mentoring network and they're specifically saying, you know, I, from my experience, can mentor students who are from this background, who face this combination of things, then I think setting up mentoring networks which are private, where people only know sort of from within the group, you know, how, and people can, within subgroups, can decide how they want to construct those groups, I think that might be extremely helpful. At least one of the scientific societies I'm in set up a mentoring network, and I found it useful. And I also found another trans person in neuroscience through it. So.
Do any of the other panelists have any burning points to make? Yeah, sure.
I just wanted to add a point. I think that the idea of leaving the gender category open, that just leaving a box to put in the gender that you are, is the best way to talk about gender. Because there's any kind of, you know, and it need not be an official, what you have on your official papers, but how is it that you want people to see you as? That's about it that we are, that this group should be interested in. And so it helps. The other thing I think that helps is that what the Dalit feminists taught the Savarna feminists, that, you know, that you are Savarna feminists, right? That not using a label is the privilege of only the privileged, right? So if you feel that you're a woman scientist, maybe then you keep addressing the other one as the man scientist, right? He is a man scientist. He is, and let's say man scientist, because it sounds odd, but that's how it is, right? A woman scientist and a man scientist. And I think that underlining is something that is important. That it kind of makes scientists more neutral. It, instead of collapsing the category of science into that kind of a, what we described as the Savarna, whatever man, it actually now says scientist is actually anybody can be, but you are this and this, and that kind of is important to describe you as a scientist for everybody. It's not only for the margins to get labels, it is for the center also to get questioned. I'm saying this in my college, they had this, I was in a very, very orthodox college, conservative college. And there was this list of faculty that had to be put, and they wanted to put doctor, professor against each one's names, and then they wanted to do doctor, missus. And I, of course, said, no, it cannot be there. Then they were very generous, and they said, Dr. MS. And I said, no, it cannot be there. So let's just remove it all. So then they said, no, it cannot be, because some people want it to be there. So then I changed everything to Dr. Mr., Dr. Mr., Dr. Mr., Dr. Ms., Dr. MS., MRS., whatever you want. So the point is that what is the general? Is the general unquestioned? Then we are in a bit of a problem. That the what we are considering as the scientist is each one of us has a location. Each one of us is coming from a gender, a caste, some kind of ability, some kind of disability, some whatever backgrounds. That is what defines me as a person. So let not the definitions go only for the margins. And then we can choose and pick as to who is perfect to speak for this particular issue at this moment of time. Right? And then there could be man scientists who are very good at talking about, about gender itself. It is quite possible.
Sure.
How do we do this is something, I think this question also comes in the toilet question. Right? When I came to TFR for my work way back in the 80s, there was the only women's toilet was in an absolutely outside space outside the West Canteen, which to me was very good because I didn't have to enter the haloed precincts of the institution and I could just be there. But in my institution where I was coming from, which is IIT Bombay, in a four-storied structure, which was the long buildings, which was the mark of what lab should be, the toilet was in one end of one floor, right? And that was kind of telling us, okay, this is one toilet which, you know, because we are very few women, this is what we will do. Which from a planning sense made sense to them. From a person who is looking at that campus or looking at that building, I would say that what is the harm in having gender neutral toilets on every floor? You can, and if you feel very discomforted, create gender specific toilets on alternate floors, let people travel to go to that floor, let everybody else have access to more toilets, and remove those urinals from there. Because I think scientists need to speak about why urinals are not necessary. That you know, that when surgeons come and tell us that the success of a surgery for a trans man is that he can stand and pee, I want to go right under this table, because I do not understand what is this meaning of man that doctor is making. And so somewhere institutions, these are small things that the institution can do without, you know, making a big do about it. That how you describe this little cubicle is described by what is inside that cubicle. It is not described by who is allowed to enter that cubicle. Let us say these small things, they go a long way. That they remove the generality of the man scientist and make things better for everybody else.
Right. I love this, where we have headed. And I'm sorry, but I have to cut short the discussion because we've already overshot time. But it's amazing that, you know, the discussion has come to a point where we all come from different silos, we have these different boxes, and then we are coming together. Either we get discomforted together or we become comfortable together. So I love the way we have kind of ended this discussion, and I would love to take some of the most.
Just a quick plug. If you, I would strongly encourage you, if you would like to set up a trans-friendly infrastructure at your institution, please do get in touch. I'm sure Chayanika can also help you, having thought about this for many years. Apart from bathrooms, I think it's just really important that trans people have a way to live and in our self-identified genders while at work. And that takes some, you know, institutional sort of tweaking of certificate names and, you know, names on degrees and various things like that. If you get an applicant who seems to have two names, one on ID, one on certificates, don't be fazed, this is probably just a trans person, right? So I just want to put that out there. And yeah,
it could also be a married woman.
Yes,
it could also be a married woman. Absolutely.
Yeah. So I think so please do contact us if you'd like to set up something that lets trans students know that there's an infrastructure that will support them if they come out.
I love this, that we are ending on a positive note. What we can do, what were the ills of the past, what we can do. And I think we should take this discussion forward and keep discussing this in more spaces, more academic spaces, as well as non-academic spaces, because that's where homes are, that's where parents are, that's where children are, you know, being brought up on a daily basis and educated on a daily basis. So I think this conversation needs to move forward to those spaces as well. So I thank all the panelists for being such wonderful panelists today and giving such beautiful insight. I'm actually having tingling skin right now because I've heard such good things from all of you. I feel like a student all over again today, finally. I'm really happy to have been part of this discussion, and thank Aniket and the others in Master of Science for giving us this opportunity. Thank you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Chatting with all of you. Thank you.